Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and this particular series is entitled The Teachings of Jesus. And this is lesson number 8 in that series, and it focuses on what Jesus said about the church. Suppose he could be talking about us? This lesson is for August 23 of 2014. And if by chance you might like to use some of the ideas that we talk about here, some of our handouts, they're all available on our website at theox, that's theox.org, and that website will be visible on your screen from time to time. I hope you have your Bible handy, because we're going to look at a lot of Bible verses, and let's begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, we've come here to praise you and to recognize how much you have to offer us, what you offer us and what you expect of us as a church. We think about it. It scares us maybe in trying to understand and recognizing how far we are short of that standard. But here we are almost 170 years since the great disappointment. Isn't it about time we got our act together? Send us the Holy Spirit. Give us the willingness to allow Him access to our lives, to our thinking, to make the kind of changes necessary to bring us into your kingdom is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. What does God want to call all of us?
His children?
His children. We're all sons and daughters of God, right? Mm-hmm. And he said that way back from when? Way back in the beginning, in the early years, early books of the Old Testament. And what do we see in actual fact down through history? Has God had a great, huge number of faithful people following him all along?
No.
Well, there was Adam and Eve, and there was Enoch, and there was Noah, maybe Shem, and then later there was Abraham, and, well, I don't know, there was Moses, and, you know, you could just almost, of course, these are the ones we know about. There must have been others somewhere.
Well, what about the 5,000 who had bowed the knee to Baal? Well,
just the fact that they had not... just not bowed their knee to Baal didn't mean they were necessarily saints.
At the time of Noah, there was Noah, and there were only 7 other people that even got on the boat, and none of those 8 were all wonderful.
Well, Ellen White makes it very clear that God's church, if I can use that name in quotation marks, is not any official organization, but rather a group of believing, trusting, faithful Christians whose faith is firmly set both intellectually and spiritually in the Lord, Jesus Christ, so that they cannot be moved. And you would find that in Volume 4 of the SDA Bible Commentary, page 1161, paragraph 6.
Are some of those people not Sabbath keepers?
Well, you know, I would love to quote Ellen White every time I have a chance. You know, she says, despite the problems in those other churches, the vast majority of God's faithful people are still in the other communions.
Yeah. It would be wonderful if we could see the world from God's view, and like if all his children were purple and all the others were, and we could look around and see, and oh wow, look, some from this church and that church and that church. And that would be a wonderful view for us to have, but we're compartmentalized down here, and we don't see that.
So what's the purpose of the church? I mean, if all those people are doing just fine, what do they need us for? What's the purpose for our church?
How do we get like this? Do you think there are a higher percentage of those kind of people in the Seventh-day Adventist Church?
Well,
Hopefully.
I think there's plenty, but I mean, if you got all these other fine Christian people that are going to heaven in other churches, what are we, I mean, it says here the church, what's the, I hope you're going to address what our purpose is here today.
Yes.
Do you think the purpose?
It's purpose of the Adventist church, not Ellen White's definition of church.
Yeah.
Do you think the purpose of the church is to hold God's truth and to share God's truth?
Absolutely.
So his truth goes marching on, and even though we're imperfect, God's truth, without the church, God's truth would not be marching on?
Okay, let's recognize a couple of points right up front. One, if there is a concentration of saints in the Seventh-day Adventist church, remember I said if. I'm not saying there are, I'm not saying there aren't. If there's a concentration of saints in the Adventist church, where do you think the devil is going to be working the hardest?
Right there.
I mean, and I have said many times in classes, and maybe I need to say it to all of you out there, we need to learn how to practice, we need to practice thinking like God and thinking like the devil. We need to understand what's going on behind the scenes in the Bible stories. So we get ready to say, when the devil shows up looking like Jesus and claiming to be Jesus, we will be able to tell, hey, that doesn't ring true. He's lying to us. We've got to practice doing that. Well, we know that down through the centuries, there have been doctrinal difficulties and conflicts, there have been cultural differences, there have been a host of smaller things that have almost torn the church apart on many occasions. And even today, there are divisive issues. I mean, look at the world around us, even look at within our church. What are the divisive issues? Recently, there's been a lot of talk about what's the role of Ellen White. There's been a lot of talk about should we ordain women. There's been a lot of talk about should we accept homosexuals in our church? Could a homosexual even be a pastor? Wow.
And even creation.
Wow, even talking about people who believe in creation? Imagine it. Well, we must recognize that the church is not a human organization. Christ himself is the one who established the church and is its rightful head. He claims the church as his future bride. He said, I build my church, Matthew 16, verse 18. And he is the giant, unmovable rock and cornerstone of the church's existence upon which each of us has an opportunity to build as a smaller stone into the church's everlasting structure. So in this lesson, we will discuss the foundation of the church. And what's the foundation of the church?
Jesus.
Jesus Christ, the great cornerstone. And the unity of the church. And we're going to talk about what unity means as we move along. Well, this lesson, the first part of this lesson, of course, is based on the famous text of Matthew 16. Let's look at that real quick. Matthew 16, remember, Jesus has taken his disciples out of Galilee. He had to take them out of Judea because the Pharisees and Sadducees were trying to catch him and kill him down there. Now he's been working in Galilee for a year, and they're trying to arrest him there. So he takes his disciples and says, let's get out of here for a while. And they travel off to Tyre and Sidon, and then they travel around way up to Caesarea Philippi. I had the privilege of visiting there last summer. Caesarea Philippi, and it's a place that was full of pagan temples. And they're looking around at all these grand structures that were dedicated to these crazy gods. And Jesus turns to his disciples and he says, what?
Who do men say I am?
Who do men say I am? And their response is, well, some say Moses and some say Elijah and some say maybe Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then Jesus turns to them again and he says, but what about you? Who do you say I am? And what happened?
Peter talked again.
Peter, you know, Peter had to speak up. I mean, somebody's got to speak up, and who could better speak up than Peter, right? Well, what did he say?
You are the Messiah.
Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. I wish he had really believed that and understood what he was saying and lived according to that for the rest of his life. Wow.
So he just sort of said it and
he didn't know what he was saying.
He didn't know what he was saying. Mm-hmm.
Good for you, Simon, son of John, answered Jesus, for this truth did not come to you from any human being, but it was given to you directly by my Father in heaven. And so I tell you, Peter, you are a rock, and the word for rock in Greek, now Jesus was speaking Aramaic, not Greek, but the version we have is in Greek in the book of Matthew. You are a rock, the Greek word is Petros, and on this rock foundation, and that word is Petra, slightly different, on this rock foundation I will build my church. Notice, I will build my church. Whose church is it?
Jesus.
And not even death will ever be able to overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. What you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven.
Is this a new church?
What do you mean by a new church?
Well, I don't know. God has always had people who have been faithful and follow him, so aren't they a church? So, I mean, wouldn't it be considered that Noah and the people in his day who were faithful, wouldn't that be God's church? And Abraham and those people who were faithful, wouldn't they be God's church? And
well, it's interesting that you should mention that, because there are two general approaches to this issue. There are those who say the faithful have always been God's church, and the scriptures are a product of those people. And therefore, today, we as representatives of those people, if necessary, can change the scripture to meet our needs, because we produced the scripture back in the beginning. Mm-hmm. That is the attitude of the Roman Catholic Church and a lot of other church groups. Seventh-day Adventists have taken the opposite approach, among others, among a lot of Protestant organizations at one point in time. Now some of them are sort of moving, but we have taken the attitude that the Holy Spirit inspired the scripture, and what he said at every time in the past still is valid until today, and no one today has the right or the privilege or the authority to change something that was said through, maybe it was culturally appropriate for those people in those days, and maybe that's not culturally appropriate for us today, but the basic principles still hold, and the church is supposed to live up to that standard. It doesn't have the right to change that standard according to its needs. And the Catholic Church, of course, has carried that the next step. They have said, well, God gave the keys to Peter, and Peter handed them on to the next pope, and who's handed down now. And now they would say that literally Pope Francis today, speaking as he does from time to time ex cathedra from his seat of authority in Rome, has the right, he has the authority, he would not do this, but he has the authority to completely change the Bible if he sees fit. And we know some cases where the church has changed major issues in the Bible. Can you think of an example?
Ten Commandments.
The Sabbath commandment, particularly. Yeah, exactly.
And the second commandment.
And they would say, we have a right to do that. And they would claim to be a part of that, you know, that spiritual heritage all the way from Adam. And they say, we produce the Bible, therefore we have the right to change the Bible if we want to. And we have to decide individually which side of that argument are we going to be on. Well, you know that one of the things that Roman Catholics don't take into account, and which most Protestants haven't, when they discuss things with Roman Catholics, haven't paid attention to, which they should have, is that a couple chapters later in Matthew 18, Jesus said, and so I tell all of you, talking to all that are the disciples, what you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. In other words, who's he given the keys to?
The disciples.
All his disciples have these keys, and the basic same idea is presented in John, the Gospel of John.
What does it mean what you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven. What you allow on earth will be allowed in heaven. To me, that's confusing.
Okay. What God is saying there is that the church, if it's functioning ideally, will guide people to do things. I mean, as they make a decision here on earth, it will be a decision which is guided by principles from heaven. So God is saying, we're going to march along here together. The true Christians will be marching in God's way, and God will bless them. So whatever they see on earth will be as good as if it came from heaven.
These keys,
yeah,
what are they?
The scriptures. There's only one key. It's the scriptures.
Oh, how interesting.
And that same key fits heaven and it fits hell, according to the Bible. So in other words, how you respond to God's word in scripture determines whether that key is going to open heaven to you or whether it's going to open hell to you.
So
looked at me in a stupor of some kind, as if this was gospel news.
The keys were given to Peter and all the other disciples. Now, why does Peter think he has an extra special key?
Peter didn't, but people who follow along claim that Peter did.
I let my mind wander. I wonder where the keys went when there were two or three popes all fighting each other at the same time.
You're not supposed to know about that. Well, it's interesting that if you really want to know who was given authority here, if you look at the context in Matthew 16, Jesus spoke those words to Peter, Matthew 16 verses 13 to 20. It's only discussing one thing, and that's Christ's identity and mission. He's not talking about Peter's mission. Matthew 24 and 25, Jesus said, "So then, anyone hears these words of mine and obeys them is like a wise man who builds his house on a rock." So who's the rock?
Christ.
Of course. These teachings of mine. Furthermore, in his speech recorded in Acts 4, verses 11 and 12, what did Peter himself say? Jesus is the one whom the scripture says, the stone that you, the builders, had despised turned out to be the most important of all. Salvation is to be found through him alone. In all the world, there is no one else whom God has given who can save us. So who does he call the stone?
Christ.
Jesus.
So Jesus never said, Peter, upon your words, no.
And Peter, when he wrote his epistles, 1 Peter 2, look at these words from verse 4 to 8. Come to the Lord, the living stone, rejected by people as worthless, but chosen by God as valuable. Come as living stones, and let yourselves be used in building the spiritual temple. So Jesus is supposed to be the foundation, the cornerstone, but each one of us is supposed to be a brick in that building. Where you serve, he says, that spiritual temple where you will serve as holy priests to offer spiritual and acceptable sacrifices to God through Jesus Christ. For the scripture says, I chose a valuable stone which I am placing as a cornerstone in Zion, and whoever believes in him will never be disappointed. The stone is of great value for you that believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone which the builders rejected is worthless, turned out to be the most important of all. And another scripture says, this is the stone that will make people stumble, the rock that will make them fall. And of course, that's right out of Matthew 22, and it's talking about Jesus, isn't it?
If Peter were here today, would he be horrified to know that he was considered the cornerstone?
He would be horrified.
Ephesians 2:19 and 20 support.
Getting ready to go there.
Okay.
But let's read that right now. That's appropriate. To talk about how God's church is built, let's start with 19. So then, you Gentiles are not foreigners or strangers any longer. You are now fellow citizens with God's people and members of the family of God. You too are built upon the foundation laid by the apostles and prophets, the cornerstone being Christ Jesus himself. There's no question in Paul's mind about who the cornerstone was, right?
How did Peter die, just briefly?
He was crucified upside down.
Upside down on his
choice. Okay, so he just would not consider himself Christ by any.
No.
And yet we do.
He thought it would be too honorable a thing to be crucified even right side up as Jesus was. He said, I don't even deserve to be crucified in the same way Jesus was.
He might even say, I barely deserve to be a stone in the foundation.
That's basically what he is saying. Yeah.
Let alone the cornerstone.
Well, there are many places in the Old Testament where God is called a rock. The Lord is your mighty defender, your rock. That's Deuteronomy 32, verse 4, Psalm 28, verse 1, 31, verses 2, 3, many places in Psalms. And you go over to the New Testament, Romans 9, 20, 33. Look, I place in Zion a stone that will make people stumble. And again, he's referring to Jesus, a rock that will make them fall. But whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. And I particularly like this one from 1 Corinthians 3:11. For God has already placed Jesus Christ as the one and only foundation, and no other foundation can be laid.
But Jesus does seem to indicate that there in that passage about that Peter is a rock and so forth, that there's something very special about Peter.
Well, I mean, we're all supposed to be rocks. We're supposed to be bricks, if you will, or rocks, and we're supposed to be part of the walls that build up Christ's church. Yeah. But none of us is supposed to try to take the place of the chief cornerstone.
Where does it say that the rock of Jesus will break you?
Oh, yeah, that's back over there in Matthew 22, I believe. Give me just a second. I think I can find that.
What does that mean, that Jesus, as the cornerstone, he can make you, or you will break yourself on him?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't mean to pull you off, but...
Yeah. Let's see.
What did Jesus mean by that?
Well, he says, and what I should have done is done what I do always at home. Let me just find it for you.
You will shatter on the rock.
Mm.
Going back to what Jay said, if the conversation had been with John or Mark, I mean, if they had been the ones to speak up saying, who am I, and responding, would Christ have said the same thing as he did to Peter? Just happened to be that Peter was the one that responded.
I think your question
was the vocal one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Breaks you apart and gets you focused properly.
Well, I'm not.
Okay, well, we can take that up next week.
Yeah, that's all right. It's right there in chapters somewhere between 20 and 22 or 23. Matthew.
In Matthew, okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'll read it.
Okay. Well, it's interesting that in talking about unity now, we're moving into discussion of unity. There are many challenges to unity in the New Testament, within the New Testament church. And Jesus recognized this, that this was coming, even in his prayer, his final prayer recorded in John 17. And what do we see him talking about in that prayer? Do you remember what it says there?
Unity.
He first prays for unity between himself and his Father.
Mm-hmm.
What does he pray for next? A unity between himself and his first disciples. And the next? Finally, he prays for a unity between himself, his disciples, the Father, and all those who believe because of the testimony of those first disciples. Now, who does that include?
Us.
What are we talking about unity here?
Yeah, define unity.
Mm. Well, okay.
All these people are, we're all unified because they believe like I believe?
Well, that's the question. What does unity imply?
There's people that were wanting me to be unified with them and agree with them, and I don't agree with them.
So what is the difference between unity and uniformity? Is there supposed to be a difference?
Yes.
Okay, yes.
There's a difference.
Straining at gnats here.
I think there's an overlap.
What?
I think there's an overlap. Unity, to me, it means we're all heading in the right direction. Uniformity is more like if we're all doctrinally similar. You could also, you know, sort of equate you as an army. You wear a uniform. You're heading. But I think it's linked.
Unity implies uniformity.
No.
Does it? Well, uniformity would mean we would all be. We would look the same.
Yeah.
We would speak the same.
Well, that's.
We would have the same cultural background.
Not necessarily. That's going to an extreme.
That's uniformity.
I think of uniformity as being a specific church, a denomination, and unity being that we all believe that Christ is the Son of God. And
well,
similar so but different.
If we have differences of opinion about how certain things should be done in the Adventist church, is that still unity? It's not uniformity.
It's not unity.
No,
either.
But you can break that down into
harmony. Harmony would be a better. This has some individuality, but you're not pulling it. Different.
Oh, I love the word harmony because that means you're getting along and harmony.
Yeah, Laodicean. They're nice and harmonious.
You've probably heard this illustration before, but I think this is the only one that we can fairly say, and that's it. A bicycle wheel has a lot of spokes. And if you're way out there and you're on that end of the tire and the other one is on the other end way down here somewhere, you may be quite separated, quite different. But as those spokes come closer and closer together, what happens? If Jesus Christ is the true hub of the church, as we become closer and closer to him, as we come closer and closer to him, as we become more and more like him, what's going to happen to our differences?
And be smaller.
Those differences are going to meld away and we'll all be united in a nice ecumenical movement.
Okay. What about the ecumenical movement? Should we be a part of it?
Sure. We want to be unified here.
No.
Do we want to be unified? I don't think I need to, it's a surprise to any of you to know that Pope Francis, the new Pope of the Roman Catholic Church, he's doing everything he can to reach his arms out and he says, we need all our Christian, our separated brethren to come back to the Mother Church.
In the same breath they say, forget about teaching. They use the word doctrine. You'll figure that out when you go to heaven. What a backwards way of doing things.
You know, if a person did not have values or did not want truth, it would be easy to be, to combine. Mm-hmm. But the minute you hold values and you hold what you think is truth, it's very difficult to give those up. It's almost like giving up part of your personhood. So if the population can be valueless, maybe there can be...
Well, what are the major threats to unity within the church? And maybe for a while here, we should just talk about the Seventh-day Adventist Church. What are the major threats to unity within the Seventh-day Adventist Church?
Women wanting to be ordained or ordained?
Perceptions and understandings.
I think we need to be a little more general than that.
Give us general.
Selfishness.
Envy.
Pride. These are the worst enemies of Christian unity. When I say selfishness, I'm saying we look out at the church and we think everybody else needs to think like I do. Or somebody who has a higher position than I do in the church, I'm envious of that person. We shouldn't be envious. That person is doing a good job of spreading the gospel. We ought to be thankful that they're doing a good job spreading the gospel. Not envious.
Well, I'm not envious of Joanne when she spouts all this false doctrine.
Well, does the church have standards?
Well, what provision? Hold that question for a little bit. We're gonna really struggle with that one before we get to the end of this lesson.
What about the conference president that doesn't support my ideas on women's in ministry?
There you go. What are we going to do?
Well, it's obvious he's, what were some of those things you mentioned? He's selfish.
Yeah.
He's all those other bad things.
Yeah.
So he's disrupting, or she's disrupting, whatever it might be, the unity of the church,
okay,
and harmony and all that stuff. Joanne likes harmony here.
Well, maybe the women are disrupting the unity and harmony and reaching for the apple again.
No doubt about it.
What would we answer? What would we answer someone outside of Adventism who asks, the founder, the person we quote all the time, Helen White, is a female. Mm-hmm. And we laud and respect and all those things for Helen White. Why are we so afraid of this woman ordination situation?
Well, that's what I want to know.
Because
all those other people are selfish and hard-hearted and unkind and
unchristian.
It's because there's a whole nether class right behind the women, and that's the gay movement. So
we've got a lot of things to talk about in this lesson. Those are big issues. Those are things that are.
Can we be unified while we're undergoing these?
That's
issues?
Where I want to go. What provisions did Christ make to try to bring the church together in unity?
Oh, please tell us.
Well, I think we dealt with that early on. The priesthood of all believers versus somebody on a pinnacle and his immediate underlings, mm-hmm, are the ones that get us into heaven. Right there's a major difference.
Okay,
the rest
God,
of it, you make up your mind according to what you can figure out.
God has provided two things. The divine word, as in Scripture, and the divine word, capitalized, as being the life and death of Jesus Christ. The Father and the Son together have cooperated in giving us, and I should add the Holy Spirit as well, have cooperated in giving us the truth. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is unique, as far as I know, in history. Because what happened is, after the Great Disappointment, a relatively small group of people who said, this movement wasn't for naught. There's something in this thing that really is important to preserve. How can we come together? How can we work it out? And they said, the only way we can figure out what we should believe is to sit down with the Bible and work our way to and say, not, well, I like this idea and you like that idea, well, let's have it out here. No, sit down and say, what does the Bible teach us?
And isn't that what we're trying to do now, if people wouldn't jump the gun, is to sit down and say, what does the Bible teach us?
Yeah.
Well, but there were some people that sat down and they disagreed with our particular, they left. They disagreed and they took their unity someplace else.
Have they formed a great, wonderful, advancing church with 20 million members?
Well, no, because they didn't have Ellen White.
Well, that was
at least that was what one preacher said.
That was a very precious group to actually sit and to. That's very honorable to do.
Yeah,
and we should follow that
submit
model.
Submit themselves to say, okay, I will take. I will set aside my selfishness, my prejudices, my all that, and let's read the Bible. They read the Bible intensively, late into the night, and then on the weekends they would come together and they would say, okay, what have we learned about this particular doctrine, this particular idea? What have we learned about this particular idea? And they would hash it out. I mean, sometimes Ellen White would say there's a little more heat than light, but they worked it out. Well, in order to have unity, I need to keep pressing on here, we must agree on a common body of biblical beliefs. Without that, all efforts at unity would end in failure. And as we study the life and death of Jesus and learn to practice his love, our selfish pride must die. And that's the problem. And I quote from Signs of the Times, September 19, 1900, when those who claim to believe the truth are sanctified through the truth. Sanctified, what does that mean?
Tell us.
They come to be holy, they come to be set apart, they come to be more like Jesus through the truth. When they learn of Christ, his meekness and lowliness, what have they set aside when they're meek and lowly?
Selfishness.
Selfishness. There will be complete and perfect unity in the church. The church has always struggled with two separate, somewhat competing principles. A high view of truth on one side, and two, a deep love for one another among believers. There have been times in the history of the church when the only thing that seemed to matter was doctrine. At the present time, the pendulum is swinging in the other direction, and many Christians are talking only about love and unity. And I quote from our Bible Standard, Sabbath School Bible Study Guide, "Love without truth is blind, and truth without love is fruitless. Mind and heart must work together."
So when Paul and Barnabas separated, what kind of unity was that?
I think that God intentionally did that because now he has two teams instead of just one.
Well, we're looking for unity. You just said when things are right, they're unified. And here we've got two of the big boys, and they're separating. They aren't unified over this situation.
Yep.
So we have a juxtaposition.
They were unified in trying to spread the gospel of Jesus. The method by which they did it were different.
Mm-hmm. Well, the new head of the Roman Catholic Church, we've already talked about him a little bit, Pope Francis, is doing everything he can to appeal to the separated brethren. Guess who that would be? From other Christian groups to rejoin the Mother Church. Can't we just love each other? As we have noted in previous lessons, he has said that the biggest obstacle, this is his version of things, the biggest obstacle to church unity is people who want to strictly adhere to their divisive beliefs. He calls such people ideologues and says that they are the biggest obstacles to church unity. What did Ellen White say was the obstacle to church unity?
Pride.
Pride and selfishness.
Then people who want to stick to the truth, mm-hmm. studied and they come to the truth, are the biggest obstacles.
Well, he would say, how can that be truth when it's obstructing our love?
It's always in their direction, isn't it?
Well, in modern times, there's been a massive ecumenical movement. None of us can argue with that, among Christian churches. So if Christians are supposed to be known for their love, what could be wrong with all of us reaching out with wide open arms to embrace our Christian brethren?
Does it say anywhere in the Bible that truth is love? Isn't God love and God is truth?
Yes, it says God is truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus said. And 1 John, it says God is love. So
is there love when there's not truth?
Well, not the right kind of love anyway.
Different type, yeah.
Now, there's a problem because we in English use love to mean almost anything you can imagine. I mean, the number of variations of understanding the word of love is just almost endless. So we have to be a little bit careful. But, yes. Okay. Well, by criticizing others, we falsely believe that we are somewhat or somehow superior to them. Even in the Old Testament, God warned us of the dangers of whispered gossip and talebearing, Leviticus 19:16 and Proverbs 16:28. How often is unity spoiled by gossiping and talebearing? Are there times when we do need to speak out regarding the wrongs or bad behaviors of a fellow believer?
Occasionally.
What principles should guide our actions, our thoughts, and our speech on such occasions? And you know the famous verse in Matthew 18:15-18. Consider the following three guiding principles when you think it is necessary to speak up against a fellow believer. One, are you certain that what you're going to say is the truth? Remember that the ninth commandment makes it clear that we are not to bear false testimony. We can bear false testimony or false witness not only by openly perverting the truth, but also by putting in our report assumptions, guesses, even unconsciously judging erroneously the motives of other people. Two, is what you're going to say really going to help the church? Ephesians 4:29. If the criticism or the words we are about to speak are not designed to help build up the church, would those words better be left unsaid? And three, even if the words are critical of another, is it possible to say them in a loving way? We need to speak any critical words in the most caring, compassionate, loving way that we possibly can. If our manner of speech offends others, we are not helping to build up the church. And people who have recently come into the church see that kind of behavior, and where are they headed? Out the door. The book of James speaks a great deal about the dangers of the tongue. And you know, James 3 reflects Proverbs 26:20. Wouldn't it be best if we all practice these guidelines instead of, you know, it says that the tongue is like a fire, and how large a force can be set on fire by a tiny little bit of a match. Instead of gossiping, Ellen White says, thus creating mischief, let us tell of the matchless power of Christ and speak of his glory. We need to remember that we have never been given the task of judging others or even of comparing ourselves with others. The only one to whom we should try to compare ourselves is
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
But Ellen White talked about Dr. Kellogg.
Mm-hmm. Why? Why did she talk about Dr. Kellogg? He was trying to lead. He believed that he was so righteous and so right that he needed to lead the whole church in the wrong direction. Jesus, I can't let that happen. He wanted us all to be pantheists, believing that God is in everything. He said, no, God is a real person. Well, look at Matthew 5:23-24. So if you're about to offer your gift to God at the altar, and there you remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar, go at once and make peace with your brother, and then come back and offer your gift to God. What's Jesus trying to tell us there?
Be on good terms with people.
Is God refusing to forgive us if we still have an issue with a fellow believer? Well, Jesus went to considerable lengths to spell out exactly how differences within the church are to be handled. We just went through that. The offending party should go first to the erring person and try to resolve the issue between the two of them. Matthew 18:15, Leviticus 19:17. Try to make it as easy as possible for the erring person to recognize their mistake and resolve the issue.
And always remember that it's the other person that's wrong instead of me, right? Or is that backwards?
That's backwards.
No.
I might be the one that's wrong.
And he's using the same approach on to me. We're both being kind and loving and all of that stuff, and we're not getting anywhere.
Yeah.
He's still hung up in his error.
Well, if that person is unwilling to admit wrongdoing, step two, and thus to rectify his course, one needs to take one or two witnesses with him, Deuteronomy 19:15, and in the hearing of these, hopefully objective observers, discuss the issue. And remember the third step, if this second attempt does not accomplish the needed reconciliation, the issue should be taken to the entire church. Always such matters should be handled in the best possible way to lead to repentance and reconciliation. The goal is to promote salvation, Galatians 6:1. And I love this quote from Ellen White. What a world of gossip would be prevented if every man would remember that those who tell him the faults of others will as freely publish his faults at a favorable opportunity. So if he says, and when he turns around, he's talking to that person, who's he talking about?
You.
He's talking about you. We should endeavor to think well of all men, especially our brethren, until compelled to think otherwise. We should not hastily credit evil reports. These are often the result of envy or misunderstanding, or they may proceed from exaggeration of a partial disclosure of the facts.
And then when you are compelled to come to this other thing, this otherwise, then what do you do?
Well, let's look at a couple of possibilities. There's verse, I know that's a tough one. It would be nice if we could just stay and answer. So, but how would you deal with these two problems? Jay, here's your challenge. How should we deal with a kind, accepting, and apparently loving fellow church member who is in error regarding doctrine? What is the best approach to such a person? Or two, how should we deal with a person who appears to have the right theology, but acts in harsh, judgmental, and unloving ways toward other members? Now, which is worse?
Well, who's the kind, loving person that broke away from the church and started his own in Redlands? How did we deal? It's very hard when a person is trying to destroy something.
Yeah.
Or the kind, loving person that was trying to do it right and got disfellowshipped.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know of anyone.
Well, I'm just using an illustration. It's nobody locally here that I know of. It's nothing, but
Desmond Ford, that's the name.
We should always keep in mind the influence of our actions are having upon non-members looking at the church. Jesus forgave even the men who were crucifying him, Luke 23:34. Could we possibly have any reason for withholding forgiveness from fellow church members in light of that? Could you define the differences between unity and uniformity? Now, we've had a lot of illustrations, a lot of chance to talk. Okay, now, tell me, what's the difference between unity and uniformity? Could I, in unity, put my arms around a brother and love them, even if they don't hold every view exactly like I do?
Mm-hmm. If you're doing it right, yes.
Sure.
Yes.
That's unity. It's not uniformity, but it's unity. Well, careful research in a number of different settings has demonstrated that people who join a Christian church will remain as faithful members if they experience at least two of the following 3 points. And you want to know, if you bring somebody into the church, are they going to stay? Here are the criteria. This has been demonstrated again and again in different situations. One, they really believe that the doctrines which the church holds represent the teachings of the Bible. That's one. One out of three. Okay. Two, they experience the fellowship of a relatively small group of fellow members to whom they feel some commitment. So if they feel a part of a smaller group and they really feel fellowship, they'll stick around. And three, they enter into the overall church program and participate in one way or another. They actually get involved in the church program. If you have two of those three, you will stay with the church. Okay?
Well, some of our early members left their churches, were called out of their churches.
And why?
Well,
they didn't believe those churches were following the biblical doctrines. They didn't feel welcome because, in fact, a lot of them were disfellowshipped, including Ellen White.
Well, but surely there were other people still in the churches that were kind and loving to them, and there was other things that caused them to come out of there other than that.
Well, these three things you could, on the basis of these three things, they left.
I think a church that is arguing and debating is, you know, the world is a stressful, rough place. And you like to come to a place that is, I think, uniform, even more than unity, to relax. And when a church...
I think we're making this unity thing kind of namby-pamby.
Oh, no, not at all. I hope not.
You know, there comes a time when a house is on fire and you're shouting that it's on fire and nobody's waking up or they're not believing you or whatever, then pretty soon you start breaking the door down and you start crashing in the windows. Mm-hmm.
Well, if you don't,
I'm getting the impression here that we're kind of saying if the house is on fire and well, people are, you know, we got to be nice and polite and unified here, and I don't.
Well, and that's my next question: what is the relationship between the one hand, the emotional aspects of church life involving fellowship, Christian love, and feelings of belonging? What are those again? Emotional aspects of church living involving fellowship, Christian love, and feelings of belonging. That's the one hand. And on the other hand, the ethical aspects of church membership involving church doctrines, biblical truth, and living according to Christian standards and principles. How are those related? Now, if you can answer that in a couple of sentences, we can summarize our lesson.
Well, should the second part create the first part? Should the doctrines, biblical truth, and living according to standards and principles create a relationship between the and fellowship? Does the second one come first, or does fellowship, Christian love, and feelings create church doctrine, biblical truth?
Well, we suggested earlier that the churches historically have tended to swing back and forth. And for a while, we really emphasized doctrines and standards and biblical truth. And then the church, the Christian church as a huge body, every once in a while sort of swings back the other direction. And everything, what seems to really matter is love and peace and harmony. So what is the relationship between these two?
This side of the table has been awfully quiet. Speak.
Yeah. Maybe they're in favor of biblical truth and church doctrines. And,
I think a big problem with our, and I'm talking current churches that we're raised in, so much of our interaction these days is very superficial. Mm-hmm. It's almost impossible to get true friendship, for starters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In our modern world.
Well, yeah, you can extend it to that. I mean, there's some churches you could go in, it's as cold as a full-blown air conditioner in the summer. Really?
Yeah.
And it shouldn't be. So how can you get into all the rest of this if you can't even manage that?
Yeah, I mean, if we can't get along with the members of our own church, what kind of a standard are we erecting to show to the world?
Exactly.
Well, Christ's mission to this earth, let's nail this down now. Christ's mission to this earth was for the purpose of reestablishing the broken relationship between erring human beings and our loving Heavenly Father. Now, if I had 3 hours now, I would bring you a whole bunch of quotations that would support that, some very potent ones. We need to become so committed to the truth as revealed in Scripture says that even the devil, appearing in human form but saying he is God, cannot deceive us and lead us astray.
And we know he's going to try.
And he is going to try. Our faith must be based on the solid evidences of God's word. Consider the following words regarding the final moments before Jesus died. Now, there are a lot of people who think that we just need to believe and then we need to close our eyes and we need to take the leap of faith. And that's what makes us Christians. Now, this is talking about evidence, solid evidence. And let me read you this quotation. This is Desire of Ages, page 753, paragraph 3. Here is Jesus hanging on the cross. amid the awful darkness, apparently forsaken of God, apparently he wasn't, but it seemed to him like he was, Christ had drained the last dregs in the cup of human woe. In those dreadful hours, he had relied upon the evidence of his Father's acceptance heretofore given him. What's he relying on?
What he knew in the past about his Father.
He says, I know what my Father is like. And even if I can't feel him anywhere, I can't see him, it doesn't seem like he's doing anything for me right now. He could get me off of this cross. He could get rid of all this pain. No, despite the fact that it doesn't seem like he's doing anything for me at all right now, I know what kind of person he is, and I'm not going to give up on that truth as I know it, based on the solid evidences of my past experience with him. I read on now. He was acquainted with the character of his Father. He understood his justice, that is, his righteousness, his mercy, and his great love. By faith, he rested in him whom it had ever been his joy to obey. And as in submission he committed himself to God, the sense of the loss of his Father's favor was withdrawn by faith. What was that faith based on?
Evidence.
The evidence. By faith, Christ was victor, and a few seconds later he declared, "It is finished," and died.
Into your hands I commit my spirit.
Into your hands I commit my spirit. If we had that kind of faith relationship with God, couldn't we overcome all obstacles to unity? What if we really tried it?
We need to look for evidence.
The evidence is there. The scripture is full of it. The book Desire of Ages, man, if we just read the Desire of Ages a chapter every day and said, how can I be more like that? I can't imagine what it would do to the church. I mean, there has never been a generation that has so blessed with having truth piled upon truth, given in every possible way, presented from every possible angle, presented in the most incredible words, in I would say, in the writings particularly of Ellen White, but especially the gospel and the Bible. I mean, what more could we ask for? And how well are we doing at living the gospel which has been handed to us? And that is the question I want to leave with you for this Sabbath. We hope you have a wonderful day.